Good luck. Good afternoon. I'm Patrick Ghosh. I'm a civil fellow here on behalf of Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, and on my own behalf, I greet you today for today's lecture by Professor Brij Tanka. There are not many Japanologists in India. He is one of them, and he is. There are Japanologists, but without knowing the Japanese language, he is not that variety. He knows Japanese language as well. He has been working in the field for many, many years, and you have whatever leaflet that is with you. You can see his achievements, his books that he has written. And recently he retired from Delhi University, Chinese and Japanese Studies Department, and at the moment he is heading the Asian program in Center for Chinese Studies, which is located at the CSDS premises. Okay, now it's independent. For many years it was located there, but now it is independent. Probably it is an affiliated. It's affiliated to DU.
Isn't it?
No. Is it independent? Purely independent? Okay. It's an autonomous body concentrating its energies on knowing Japan and China in particular, as well as Korea and Vietnam and other countries. He is going to speak on India and Japan, varieties of Asian regionalism. I'll speak something on regionalism later, towards the end. But you all know that India and Japan have kind of love-hate relationship for about 100 years. And after 1904 and 5, Russo-Japanese War, there's a lot of enthusiasm in India amongst the nationalists that here is one Asian country for the first time had defeated a European country. That was a great event, and it was it had an impact on India's national movement. Then in the second decade of the 20th century, we know that Tagore had visited many times Japan, but the visit that he made in 1916 that became a bit of bit controversial in Japan, because Tagore could not agree with the type of nationalism that Japan was in the process of promoting at that time. It was basking in the glory of its imperial achievements, which Tagore could not appreciate. As a result, what happened that when he had been invited to Japan, he was given a grand ovation, but by the time his lecture started sinking into the Japanese mind or in Japanese audience, then they started distancing themselves from him. And the story goes that when he left Japan after his stay in 1916, there was only one person to see him off, and that was his host. Nobody else had come. Then, of course, we have some interaction through the INA and its activities, particularly Suvasbos, who had gone there to Japan. I'm not going into that story. In short, India had a kind of topsy-turvy relationship with Japan for the entire period before the Second World War. And after the Second World War, that is the story which Brij is going to share with us, and I hope you'll enjoy. Actually, the style of this program is that we have this talk for about 40 minutes, and then we'll have a round of discussion, question answer. Okay. Now over to Dr.
Thank you. First of all, let me thank Professor Rajan and Timothy for calling me here to give this talk. I'm not sure whether I'm a Japanologist, but I've been working on Japanese history, and but of late I've become interested in the contemporary period, mostly in the 19th century. But I became interested in the India's reactions and relationship with India's reactions to what was happening in Asia and India and Japan's relationship. But not merely in terms of bilateral relations, but trying to think about how we could think about Japanese history or Indian history within a larger Asian framework. I'll read out the paper, but it's not a well worked out, it was a complete whole, it's a sort of a beginning, if you will. And the entry point of this work was, I was looking at some newspaper reports about the 1962 conflict in the Japanese press, and I was intrigued by the reactions, and so then I began looking at Japan's Asia policy, Nehru's non-alignment, and how India was relating to Asian neighbors, and tried to locate this in the whole context of what does the Asian community mean? Is there an Asian community? And how can we think critically about the rise of Asia? So it's in that context. I have, unfortunately, I couldn't get enough visuals, but I have a few. So I get bored of the talks and look at the visuals. Asia is no longer the future, it seems to have arrived. Talk of the Asian century is pervasive, even when commentators point to the existing instabilities and the uncertain base on which the Asian strength rests. The rise of Asia is now commonly equated with the rise of China and in a subsequent role, the rise of India. What does this rise mean? Is there an Asia that has risen? And if it has risen, from where and to what has it risen? Thinking about the problems and possibilities of an Asian regionalism, I look in this paper at one component of this larger problem, India and Japan's relationship during the 1950s and early 60s. It was during this crucial phase that the groundwork for their modern relationship was laid. India in this period was emerging as one of the chief architects of non-alignment, and Japan was in the process of creating a new foreign policy framework within the American alliance. I will examine the different compulsions behind Indian and Japanese policies and how they sought to articulate a new Asian agenda. I will look at the response to non-alignment in Japan through the reaction of the Japanese media to the 1962 India-China conflict, a conflict which dealt a severe blow to Asian unity. This, I would suggest, offers a way to think about the India-Japan relationship within an Asian context and points to the varieties of regionalism that operated then and their continuing impact today. My intent is to question the dominant paradigm in which India-Japan relations are discussed. This is a paradigm that can be called one of parallel narratives. India achieves independence and seeks to carve a future outside the global divisions of the post-war world. This it does through the non-aligned movement till it begins to erode the conflict between the members, India and China, to begin with, and its perceived irrelevance in global politics leads to the movement's marginalization. After a long hiatus, India begins the process of economic liberalization in 1991 and begins to jettison these earlier idealistic objectives and moves closer to the United States, and consequently, its relationship with Japan are also strengthened. The Japanese narrative is that of a defeated colonial power transforming under the US-led Allied occupation after the war into an integral ally of the United States, based on the principle of a strong economy and a weak army. This is actually a reversal of the slogan which, when in the 19th century, the Japanese government started developing modern institutions, they crafted a slogan called Rich Country, Strong Army. So in the post-war period, this was turned on its head, if you will. So you have a military alliance with the United States and you don't spend money on the military to develop your economy instead. Whereby Japan focused on economic development under the US nuclear umbrella and did not take an independent position on most foreign policy matters. So it's only when India and the US begin to come together because of the so-called Chinese threat that Japan begins to see India as a potential partner. These two parallel narratives intersect when the US face to the potential threat of China begins to reorder its relationship in the region. So it is US policy that is the key determinant in this framework. Boldly put, this overgeneralized account represents the way the trajectory of the India-Japan relationship is defined. I argue that by complicating and historicizing these dominant narratives, that it becomes possible to move out of a state-centered perspective, think about the relationship between India and Japan, indeed India and the rest of the East Asian region, in a more nuanced manner. The diplomatic policies of the two countries emerge from a complex historical background that has defined the larger network of relationships in the social and economic sphere. In this essay, I will touch on the crucial elements that shape the policies of the post-Second World War world. These are the meaning of the rise of Asia, Nehru and the policy of non-alignment, Japan's Asian policy, particularly in the late 50s and early 60s under the government of Kishi Nobusuke, and finally of the Japanese media's response to the 62 India-China conflict to show how ideas of a new Asia were shaping Japanese public perception. First, let us understand Asia has been a colonial construction, what a scholar of Japan, Harry Harutunian, called a simulacrum of reality, a place not located on any map, but a creation of the imperial imagination, a way to rule in Edward Said's influential analysis of Orientalism. But now Asia has taken a life, and this life today has reversed the old Oriental shibboleth. Now Asian superiority of the West is based on its rising economic power, and the value systems that provide the basis for cohesive society. The equation of Asia with capitalism is a major transformation of the Asian dream, which began in the mid-19th century with the assertion of intellectual superiority, when Asianists argued for a combination of Eastern spirit and Western technology. In Japan, it was in 1867 that this concept was coined. Even then, there were internal contradictions. Japan's imperialists had a hierarchic vision of Asia, and China was their own Orient. So even as Japan revolted against the West, it has created its own subservient Orient. Today, the metropolitan centers of Asian countries are not posed as alternatives, but as superior to their Western counterparts in replicating higher and more luxurious buildings, state-of-the-art transportation, and finer works of public art. This was not true of earlier Asian and Third World solidarity that put forward a different vision of the world, indeed an alternative to Western capitalism. The rise of Asia, and more broadly the non-Western world, is also not a new phenomenon. Many different trajectories can be plotted. The rise of nationalist movements and their success in Asia and Africa was the first emergence of a rising Asia, a transformation that would lead to not just national independence, but also mark the beginning of a global realignment of power. The rise of Japan as a modern nation state and its success in militarily defeating Russia, a European power, had a powerful impact and gave birth to what Binoy Kumar Sarkar, one of the founding fathers of modern sociology in India, called the birth of young Asia. He wrote this in a book called The Futurism of Asia. He'd been influenced while in Italy by the futurist movement, it's a movement in art. Hence the title. Japan became a colonial power even as it sought to project itself as a liberator of Asia. In the early 20th century, Japan's rise as an industrial nation and a colonized power was seen as the rise of an Asian power. Again from the 1960s, first Japan and then the so-called Asian tigers became the flag bearers of a free market entrepreneurial spirit where political authoritarianism was not tolerated, but sustained by the U.S. The economic centric view, while an important pointer to the changing global balance, also ignores the more recent and perhaps more significant transformations in the region. The democratizing of South Korea, Taiwan, the Philippines, and other formerly authoritarian states. It ignores the revolutionary changes that are taking place in other parts of Asia, notably West, in recent months. It also ignores the intellectual and political experiments that are being carried out in these societies and their impact in shaping very different futures. Finally, with the end of the Second World War, the emergence of a new political geography as former colonized nations became independent was a process that was neither quick nor easy. It often involved armed struggle and victory was not predetermined as the political environment became deeply divided. The former colonizers did not give up the fight easily. Rather, the United States and Western Europe began a series of military alliances as a bulwark to contain and strengthen their dominance. The United States had begun to build a network of alliances to expand its reach and was maneuvering to counter the growing power of the USSR
through CENTO, and the People's Republic of China through CFO. The former colonial powers, such as the British and French, fought to regain territories lost to Japanese colonialism. Armed conflict was the order of the day. It is in this divisive environment where conflict was endemic that the policies pursued by India and Japan need to be located, both in their very different ways, faced comparable challenges. Now I'd like to step back a little bit to look at some types of, the whole idea of pan-nationism in Japan at least is very closely interlinked to Japan's colonial mission, as it were, as justification for its colonizing Korea and Taiwan and Southeast Asia. But pan-nation ideas had a much more complex root. And one strand of it was certainly not linked to the state, and I'd like to just touch briefly on this. It's not my purpose to explore pan-nation ideas, which in the main serve to provide a rationale to build its colonial empire, but to suggest that it has a more complex history and history. A broad division can be distinguished, made distinguishing state-centered ideas and people-centered Asianist programs. The Asian Solidarity Society, established in Tokyo in 1907 by a group of Chinese and Indians, and which also included Filipinos, Koreans, and Japanese, is a good example of a people-centered grouping and the challenges that it endeavors faced. The society grew out of a meeting that a group of Indians in Tokyo had held to commemorate the anniversary of Shivaji. In the independence movement, of course, because of his struggle against an imperial power, he became a popular nationalist icon in India. The Chinese were very intrigued by this and very interested. Chang Ping Lin, he's a well-known Chinese intellectual who linguist, etymologist, philosopher, and he spent time in Japan and became editor of an influential magazine, People's Voice, Minpao. Chang Bing Lin, who was part of the society, was very impressed by this celebration, as the parallels between the Chinese radicals' anti-Manchu position was striking. Chang wrote an article to the Ningbao on the commemoration of this event. The Asian Solidarity Society grew out of the interaction between exiled revolutionaries who had come together in Tokyo and found a common platform. Japanese socialists attended the early meetings but found nationalism a restrictive basis for solidarity, and forcefully argued that the emphasis should be on fighting capitalism and not independent struggles. The failure of the Japanese to understand the importance of national independence led to the breakup of the society after mere 18 months, but during its short-lived life, it did articulate a radical agenda that sought to ground its alliance in a shared past while recognizing both differences and the new influences coming from the colonizing West. One of the members, Liu Xiaofei, a Chinese anarchist, he wrote an article called On the Recent Trends in Asia, again 1907, where he argued that today Asia is united by shared cultural experience. The Chinese language for Japan, Korea, and Vietnam, of Buddhism from India, which has spread all over Asia, of Islam, which has spread from the Arabs to Persia and India, the presence of Muslims and Indian Brahmins in the southern seas, that's Southeast Asia, Nanyang. And to the familiarity of Indians and Filipinos with British and American culture. This points to a unity based not only on the dominance of one cultural or political model, but rather seems to be an attempt to forge a unity based on the existing interactions and shared beliefs and practices. And one that sees unity in the shared experience of Western modernity as well. Rebecca Carr, a historian, argued that there have also emerging Asia that have both historical dynamism and contemporary relevance. It de-emphasized the state and elevated the people and sought to establish a contemporary political identity that based its political program on principles that accepted diversity of race and culture. The ideas that Carr finds in the Chinese intellectuals can be found among contemporaries. I mentioned this one, Vinod Kumar Sarkaram, I just mentioned. In the book on Futurism of Asia, he looked at Asian unity as based not on trade and cultural contact. He said even if Buddhism hadn't gone, even if we had no contact with the Chinese or Southeast Asians, there would still be a unity because we are all polytheistic. And remember, this is at a time when monotheism was privileged, if you will.
modernity seemed to imply that we should have a religion which was like Christianity, and polytheism was seen as something undeveloped. And Sarkar compared polytheism in religion to republicanism as a political ideal. Now to come to Nehru and ideas about the commonalities that bound India to Asia grew out of a long history of trade and cultural interaction. The opium trade with China as well as other links forged during the colonial period brought Indians into contact with Asians both in Asia as well as in the imperial metropolitan centers. Writers like Tagore, historians in the Greater India Society, and others contributed to looking at India in this wider framework. For instance, just to give one example, Chittaranjan Das in his presidential address at the Gaya session in Congress in 1922 stated that India could not remain outside the Asian Union. The idea of a pan-Asiatic federation was supported by the Swaraj Party formed by Das after his resignation from the Congress presidentship. Later, Subhashchandra Bose would lead the INA with Japanese support. These are more problematic issues, but essentially because the Pan-Asiatic Federation was an organization established by the Japanese, so it had links with the colonial empire, and so there were issues here. But the fact is that already there is a fair amount of trade and cultural relations, trade relations on which Indians have become sort of aware of and participating in what is happening in China, Japan, Southeast Asia. The Indian communities there, Indian exiled nationalists go to these countries, set up organizations, and they come, and of course, as I said, they also come into contact with people from Asia, Africa, and Latin America, in England, in Tokyo, in Paris, in other places. Jawaharlal Nehru worked hard to promote ties with Asian countries, particularly China. He first met the Chinese political leaders at the International Conference Against Imperialism, organized by the Kuomintang in 1927. He had supported China against Japan in 1938 and helped send a medical unit to provide much needed assistance to Chinese fighting the Japanese. After independence, Nehru was instrumental in convening the Asian Relations Conference in 1947 in Delhi, where he grandly declared, apart from the fact that India herself is emerging into freedom and independence, she is the natural center and focal point of the many forces at work in Asia. Geography is a compelling factor, and geographically she is situated as to be the meeting point of Western and Northern, Eastern and Southeast Asia. Streams of culture have come to India from the West and the East and been absorbed in Asia. At the same time, streams of culture flowed from India to different parts of Asia. If you would know India, you have to go to Afghanistan and Western Asia, to Central Asia, China and Japan, and to the countries of Southeast Asia. There you will find magnificent evidence of the vitality of India's culture which spread out and influenced vast numbers of people. A statement that can be read in many ways, but it should be tempered with the other aspects of this vision, in particular the fight for human rights. The Indian delegation to the UN was very heavily involved in the Human Rights Commission, established in December 1946. The Indian delegate Hansa Mehta, who helped draft the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, proposed that a Human Rights Commission and an international court be established under the UN General Assembly. The proposal was not accepted, but in the Indian Constitution, the violation of human rights was made an actionable offense. This was seen as the first step in making the UN a post-sovereign global body. This vision of a global order underlay the policy initiatives the government was taking. The importance of what today is called soft power was also clearly understood and put to the service of these ideas. Delhi hosted the first Asian Games in 1951, largely due to the this is Gandhi at the Asian Relations Conference. You can actually hear a recording of his speech as well. It's a little squeaky, but I think that these are the countries which participated in the Asian Games. These games he thought would mark India's emergence as the leader of a resurgent Asia. And what is significant is that Japan was invited. Japan has not been invited to the London Olympics after the war. The sports historian Borya Mazumdar writes, the Olympic movement has so caught the imagination of sports administrators in India that they played a pioneering role in building the Asian Games movement. It was also intrinsically linked to the larger Indian self image of being a major Asian power and the Nehruvian idea of India's centrality in the new global order. Significantly, Nehru also used other diplomatic means to strengthen India's relationship. India not only refused reparations from Japan, but Nehru reached out to the people by sending an elephant as a gift to the children of Japan in response to a letter campaign by some Japanese children. The reception of the elephant named after daughter Indira was massive. She arrived by ship on September 49 and was marched in the early morning hours of September 25th to Ueno Zoo in Tokyo, where about 2,000 people turned out to see her. The next day, the zoo was filled to capacity with about 10,000 people trying to see the new elephant. Along with the Indian elephant, there was a Thai elephant also. It's actually, there's a history to this in the sense that elephants have been exotic, obviously, in Japan, and they first entered somewhere in the early 18th century. They were brought by the Dutch from Vietnam or from Ceylon, from Sri Lanka, and they were used to be paraded from Nagasaki to Tokyo, and were there are lots of paintings and depictions of them. But during the war, one of the authorities looking at administering the zoos decided that in case of bombing and damage and so forth, the animals could escape and pose a threat. And two, particularly elephants, consumed a lot of food. And because of food shortages, they actually began killing them rather brutally. I mean, you have pictures of people coming, you know, like hunters and standing around and shooting these elephants and tigers and so forth. And it's a controversial issue which people have written about, but there was some debate about this as well. And so immediately after the war, a lot of kids particularly, there was a lot of interest in seeing elephants, and they began running special trains to Nagoya from Tokyo, because the only elephant still alive was in Nagoya. And so it's in this climate that Nehru, you know, responds and sends an elephant. In some ways, India saw its place as one of the leaders of these new nations. It recognized the need that it had to forge links with them. This was equally true of the newly emergent nations. All projected an international vision and sought to build transnational alliances based on region or religion or ideology to counter the still powerful Euro-American group of countries. They were also bound by a common objective of establishing a more equitable international order, ensuring economic development and removing poverty and inequality. The nation was not strong enough to oppose the power of the US, Europe domination of the world, and trans-regional alliances offered one bulwark of protection. Religion served to mobilize other transnational groupings, but there were political ideologies at work as well. Indonesia's former Prime Minister Muhammad Nasseri stressed that Islamic principles call for social justice and equality. In the Arab world, the pan-Arab vision, as articulated by Nasser of Egypt, represented the Egyptian desire for development and equality. Nasser denounced the UN's complicity in the displacement of the Palestinians. Nkrumah of Nigeria called for the people of color to unite and become part of a pan-African movement. In short, across the region, the internationalism that was an integral part of this new nationalism. This Asian way, Asian in the sense of those who had been ruled by colonial powers rather than any geographical meaning, can be seen even among the socialists. The socialists, while active in the socialist international, argued that the newly independent countries faced problems that differed from that of Europe and therefore needed a separate organization of their own. In March 1950, in a meeting between Indian, Indonesian, Japanese and Burmese parties in Rangoon, they decided to convene an Asian Conference of Socialists. There were different views about what the character of this organization should be, but they were all agreed that world peace was threatened by three factors: colonialism, economic disparity and the politics of scarce resources. In their search for what they called an Asian methodology to realize socialism,
he argued for the need to analyze the specific nature of the problem that Asian societies face as the first and necessary step in evolving policies to resolve them. Western colonial powers were still attempting to regain control. The Korean Peninsula was divided after the war between the Soviet-controlled North and the US and the South. And in June 1950, war broke out when the Northern military forces crossed into the South. The Indo-Chinese Peninsula was locked in a struggle against the former French colonizers who were trying to regain control after the war. The US had remained neutral in the fight once the Communist Party had established the People's Republic of China. Their objective became to control the spread of what they saw as a communist threat, and then began to help the French through military assistance. The India-Pakistan tension in the aftermath of partition and the problems of Palestine, Israel, were at that time defined as native conflicts, and so thought to be solved through local negotiations. There were debates and differences on how to resolve these conflicts, but significantly they've all agreed that the tensions where Asian people are being sucked into camps is represented by Japan. All Asia must guarantee the freedom of Japan to decide her future independent of the two camps and should take active steps to prevent the exploitation of the country by either or both camps. Considering that Japan was a defeated colonial power, this is a significant statement, and it points to the early recognition that the US, by making Japan a military ally before it ended the occupation, effectively restricted its ties with many Asian countries, in particular India. India, it should be noted, had objected to this. The Americans had occupied Japan after the war, and they signed a military treaty before they gave it back its independence. The San Francisco Peace Treaty was where Japan was given independence. Japan became a base for the U.S. Operations of the Korean Peninsula and later in Indochina. The linking of the U.S. and Japan was thus a de-linking of Japan from Asia. The turn to Asia marked the thinking of other socialists as well. In October 1960, Arlo Tatum issued a statement in Calcutta on behalf of the War Resisters International, who were then holding their 10th conference in Gandhigram in Madras State. The first time they held a meeting outside Europe. The conference was to be inaugurated by some of leading socialists such as Jai Prakash Narayan. It also included delegates from over 30 countries, including Jonilo Dolce, an influential social activist who was often called the Gandhi of Sicily. So it's in this context of transnational movements that the Afro-Asian Conference is held in Bandung in 1955. This was the context that the Afro-Asian meeting was held in Bandung, where for the first time 29 nations put forward an alternative collective foreign policy. It was, as Nehru said, a psychological moment that would produce an atmosphere of peace. It is worth recalling that the regional attempts were opposed and vociferously argued against. But one symbolic example of this is around the same time there was the Geneva Conference to settle their problems in Indochina. And Chao Enlai had also, from China, had gone to Geneva. And during the proceedings, he found himself one day in a room with John Foster Dulles, the American Secretary of State. And he put his hand out to shake hands with him, and Foster Dulles refused to shake his hand and turned out and walked out of the room. And of course, Chao Enlai was an extremely sophisticated person. He gave apparently a Gallic shrug and walked away. So, anyway, but that was the sort of divisive atmosphere that the world was in at the time. At the Bandung Conference, Chowdhury was critical both of US support for the Kuomintang in Formosa or Taiwan and of the rearming of Japan. He famously also said the population of Asia will never forget that the first atom bomb was exploded on Asian soil. I won't go into the whole question of the details of the non-aligned movement and who formulated the idea of non-alignment and Panchsheel. Nehru, the Indonesian Prime Minister Soekarno, is supposed to have formulated the idea of Panchsheel, and Nehru apparently in a speech in Egypt refers to this, and then he also uses it. But
this was the way, certainly in Indonesia, it was the way to preserve the different cultures, because Indonesia also has significant numbers of people who are Muslim or Buddhist or Hindu, so a Christian. And Sukarno and the Prime Minister Hatta thought that the Buddhist ideas of Panchin, on which they based the ideas that Panchin was based on Buddhist principles of moral conduct and so forth, would be one way of preserving both democracy and allow people to, and diversity, so to allow people to practice their different religions. These steps to resolve differences through dialogue were happening even as the US was trying to establish a system of military alliances. It invited the Colombo powers to participate in the system. Indonesia, Burma and Ceylon rejected this approach, while Pakistan, the Philippines and Thailand joined the US in September 1954 to become members of the Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, along with Britain, France, Australia and New Zealand. In December 1954, while the preparatory meeting for the Bandung Conference was being held in Bogor, the US had signed a military alliance with Formosa. And a little later, in February 1955, it created the Baghdad Pact that bound Iraq, Iran, Pakistan and Turkey to Britain and the United States. Defense Minister Krishna Menon described these measures as giving India a sense of encirclement. So Bandung was really held in a climate of political tension where the military pressure of the US was clearly apparent. And they carried on a fairly intense campaign actually to criticize the whole idea of Bandung and, you know, wishy-washy, it's this and that. Apparently the Pakistani delegate was in touch with the American ambassador and was also very critical of attempts at forming a collective action plan. So here now I'd like to look at Japan's policy. And Japan has emerged from war, defeat and occupation as a military and political ally of its former enemy, the United States. The US saw Japan as an offshore base against China and the Soviet Union, and so left the political and economic institutions of Japan largely untouched. The economy recovered to pre-war levels by 1955, and in that year the Liberal Democratic Party came to power, power that it held almost continuously until 2009. So while by the mid-50s Japan had recovered economically from the ravages of war, it had yet to begin its remarkable economic growth. The political situation was still divided, with contending visions of Japan's future and the clear consensus that marked the Japanese polity would emerge much later. That's really a product of, in the 60s it goes into double-digit growth, and from the 70s, and late 60s onward, it becomes, if you will, an economic powerhouse, and the Japanese begin to see themselves as a middle class, that we are, you know, there's hardly any difference between people between high income and low income, and everyone is partaking of this prosperity. The ruling establishment, those strong state opposition from political groupings and labor organizations, political alignments were not yet firmly fixed. Even the renewal of the Treaty of Mutual Cooperation and Security in 1960 was done in the face of widespread opposition. There were huge demonstrations. They bring the parliament, that is the Diet in Japan. The Yoshida line. Yoshida Shigeru was the Prime Minister who entered into created the alliance with the Americans, and this policy is generally referred to as the Yoshida line. Had divided society with large sections actively opposing it through their struggles against the treaty that called for ending the military alliance with the US as well as for the return of Okinawa then under the control of the US. In this process of rebuilding diplomatic ties, the government of Hatoyama in the previous 1954-56 began to restore diplomatic ties with the USSR. It concluded trade agreements with China and participated in the Bandung Conference of 55. The Hatoyama government began to place an emphasis on working through the UN and thought to play the role of a mediator or bridge between the East and West. Kishi Nobusuke, who followed, is basically remembered as a former member of the Sojo cabinet and before the war, as a right-wing conservative political leader who ran the renewal of the U.S. military security treaty through the parliament. And so he's the evil figure as far as the left progressive elements go. But what I'd like to say here is that if you look at his policies, they're not so dependent on being subservient to the United States as he is made out to be. But in fact, he and his foreign minister, Fujiyama, crafted a new Asia policy that sought to go beyond East Asia while maintaining links with the United States and making Japan self-reliant and autonomous. Kishi's efforts continue to exercise an influence and speak to the issues of today. Kishi came to power in 57 and is remembered for his foreign policy initiatives in Southeast Asia. In fact, it was not just Southeast Asia, for during his premiership, he visited 16 countries and spent 52 days traveling abroad, covering most of the major regions of the world. He played a powerful role in crafting a global vision for Japanese foreign policy. Kishi was influenced by the move to form a European common market and advocated a similar economic integration of Southeast Asia. He was active in promoting relations with China and Korea through trade agreements. Kishi importantly went beyond Japan's neighbors in East and Southeast Asia to sign cooperative agreements with India, then emerging as the leader of the non-aligned movement. And in 1958, he signaled his support of Arab nationalism by opposing the US and Britain during the Lebanon crisis of 58. There was an internal tension between Maronite Christians and Muslims over Western intervention in the Suez Canal. In 1959, Kishi visited Europe and Latin America, further broadening the ambit of Japanese diplomacy. Latin America has a sizable number of Japanese immigrants. In the 1980s, 1990s, many immigrants went to Hawaii, United States, and Peru and Brazil. Kishi Nobusuke's policy was then an Asia policy that included all of the Asian regions, West, South, and East Asia, unlike his predecessors who were focused only on the East Asian region. His policy was linked integrally to seeking self-reliance and autonomy from the United States. Kishi therefore took critical positions against the US and Britain as a supporter of Arab nationalism, but also for the US nuclear test. This opposition was one factor in his growing cooperation with India. For Kishi, building bridges in Asia was not just an economic matter, but really part of a fundamental re-examination of the principles of modern Japanese nationalism and redefining Japan's future trajectory. While he carried forward the Yoshida policy of being friendly with the United States, he also built on Hatayama's policy of becoming self-reliant through rearmament and constitutional revision. In trying to balance these two positions, he advocated cooperation with the UN, working with democratic countries and positioning Japan as a member of Asia. Indian athletes and Asian Games. These are the Nehru and Banlung. Nkrumah, Nasser, Sukarno, and Tito. No, this is Kishi. After Kishi came to India, Nehru went to Japan on his first visit. Kishi Nobusuke's Asian diplomacy was carried out within an intellectual environment that partly contested many of the objectives that Kishi sought to achieve. Rearmament and constitutional revision being the two most intensely debated in ones. They still continue to be a big problem. In this context, I think the India-China conflict has to think about the Japanese media's perception of non-alignment and how we can understand Japanese policies in the light of these public perceptions. I'm not trying to look at the India-China conflict at all. I'm just looking at how it was read in the Japanese press. And I only looked at one newspaper, so it's a very limited examination. But I looked at the Asahi Shimbun newspaper, which is it's a very big selling paper. It's a leading sort of left of center newspaper. And was very interesting that while it's anti-communist, all the reports actually, they're not just sporadic. Remember, while 62 conflict was going on, there was also the Cuban missile crisis. So the Japanese were more bothered about that than what was happening here. But what is interesting is that despite their being critical of China, of communism, was somewhat sympathetic to China, and also because of the guilt feeling after the war against what they had done in China and so forth, they would tread carefully about making criticism. On the whole, the reports are sympathetic to India's position. They are critical of China and saying that why isn't it negotiating, and so on and so forth. They look at that it's negotiated with Burma, but it's not doing it with India. But above all, I think the important point here is that they see this impacting on non-alignment and on Asian unity, and that it poses a threat. So, from the right, if you will, from the conservative Kishinobusuke to the left, there is a sense of how Japan can rebuild its relationship with an area where it's a party or colonizer, but rebuild a relationship without getting involved in the power block rivalry. So, normally, if we look at major descriptions of Japanese foreign policy of the Second World War, non-alignment, Asia, these things are sort of relegated to the margins, to the footnotes. They don't play an important role. But I think if you begin to look at some of these, if you look at the popular media, if you look at some of these reports, I think in the 50s and the 60s there was certainly a fairly widespread interest. And I'll just quote one example. If you will, it's a out example. The literary critic called Fukuda Tsuneyori, a fairly influential Japanese literary critic, who was anti-communist and a conservative writer, and he wrote an article called Questioning Pacifism, and this is a critique of socialists and Christian and left-wing movements who were talking about peace movements and so forth. And it was written in 1954, and he has a number of objections to pacifism, but what I found very interesting, significant, the last one, his last objection is, I do not understand why Nehru has become such an object of adulation. In other words, he questions, would you want a person like Nehru as a leader of your nation and so forth. So the point is that normally when you read about Japanese policies in the post-war period, these things are never figured in the main literature, but I think Nehru, non-alignment, many of these ideas of exercising a fairly significant influence on the intelligentsia particularly. If you look at scholars of Southeast Asia, East South Asia, West Asia, many of them, especially the post-war generation, have come to start studying this region mainly because of, Nehru's influence plays a significant role in shaping their interest in studying this region. So, what I'd like to suggest, what I wanted to suggest in this paper was that Nehru's non-alignment, I think if we look at situated in a larger Asian or global context, fits into other transnational movements, and that nationalism at this stage was very integrally linked with internationalism. People were trying to work out how these two could come together. And I think also that there were movements going on between states, but also at the popular level. The Asian Solidarity Society, for instance, was a meeting in the pre-war period where intellectuals, nationalists, and so forth met. And I think in the post-war period also, there are very much movements which we tend to ignore or do not factor in. And And I think it's through these people-to-people relationships that new ideas of how to restructure the region, how to think about not a centralized Asian unity, but a transnational solidarity, which I think will emerge, because now certainly the movement of people and ideas is increased both in scale and in intensity, and there's a much more livelier exchange going on than was even possible in the 1950s. So it is in that context that I think the non-aligned movement of the 50s and 60s, the transnational movement, speak to us today of how to think about regionalism. Thank you.